Hello, hello, everyone. Soundcheck. Just making sure everyone has gotten to the stream and I can actually hear myself. How are you doing, everyone? Can you hear me loud and clear? Modder, you hear me but twice. You actually hear me twice, or do you just have two tabs open with the stream? Chat, am I loud enough for you? Can you hear me good? In the meantime, I'm just gonna edit my preview thingy here. Sadly, an update. I actually just updated my main drive to a better NVMe, and I actually just lost all my scenes. So I had to real quick put a new one up. So for the next time, starting soon only should be enough. Put it somewhere in the middle. And we've got a good starting soon in the next time. So switch over to desktop. We've got a great topic for today. I'm just going to show you the wonderful topic list we've got going already. This is a pretty big list I want to do with you guys, so if you let me know if you like it. If you like the streaming and developing we do today, and we'll do that. Modder, what do you mean by we just see the start menu? On the preview and on OBS, I can see that you actually see what I've just opened. Also, I might sound a little rough. I might have been out last night. So today we'll be taking a look at custom sprite packer, which I've done some research on. Stack Overflow is always helpful in this case. Why do we need a custom sprite packer? Well, if we want to do more than one atlas, we find that the Unity default sprite packer doesn't actually support more than one. We could brute force for it, so that if one atlas is not enough, we could start a new one, but we'd have to pretty much brute force one sprite by one sprite until we find a real solution. So our solution for today is going to be taking a look at implementing a custom sprite packer, which has the ability to not only pack sprites onto an atlas, but also give us a sensation of when we need a second one or a third atlas, and ultimately create the best one we can have. In this case, it's a rather simple 2D algorithm, just a binary tree. And the this image is pretty much all you need for it. So what we will do is take a look at the atlas we have as if it's a binary tree, where each first image we put on is the root node, and further on that the right side, the free space on the right, is going to be the first node of it, and the rest space underneath it is going to be the second. So we'll pretty much be doing a binary tree implementation today. I hope it's not too quiet for you all guys. We're gonna take a look at getting some audio, some free music for next time. But for today, that's it. If you have any questions on Sim Airport, not too much on what we are going to do, that's for the normal dev stream we do with Arthur together. But like on programming and all that stuff, you can ask whatever you want today. So just take a look, this is our old Atlas Packer, and this one pretty much just uses the default Unity system. Before doing anything, I should have really taken a look if our branches are up to date. Carl, I'm gonna answer your question in a second. Let me see if our branches are the newest version. For that, I'm just using PowerShell. I've got some custom comments, but in short, it's just usual comments that you find in Git. I could show you my profile, but I can show you the comments as well. ST is just for status, a short version. Shows current anything that differs. I've also got a small little script installed that shows me the what's the difference in which branch I'm currently on live while working in it. So we see our branch is up to date, and we have now one new file which we just added. I'm actually gonna get another new branch on for this stream, which I should have done a minute ago before adding the file, but it should be fine. stream sprite packer. So Kyle, you asked what is the cons and pros of using custom picker, packer. A custom packer, the biggest positive thing about it is that we can have more than one atlas in a decent amount of time. Brute forcing with several atlases is not optimal, it's not an optimal solution, as is pretty much any time if you brute force anything. So building an optimal solution is pretty much the one point today. And it may not be optimal, our profs at uni always say there's no perfect solution, but it's gonna be way better than brute forcing. The cons of it is that we actually have to build it, and we can just use a predefined system. There's probably already a solution online, but I want to implement it, showing you how to implement it tonight and talking with you guys. So just reading up on it. Okay, so first off, we have to get a sorted list of all the images we want to add to the atlases. And specifically, we want to have the largest first. So let's do that first. Let's actually get the method up, which will return void for the moment. We can add some stuff later. That method will use the same class we've got over there, atlas texture, which is just a couple of properties together. The path, the rectangle, so we know which part of the final atlas we want to use, and the last fail change. And interestingly enough, the path, actually the name in combination with the last fail change, is also what is used to see if the atlas has to be regenerated. Also, we've also got the input texture, that is the texture that is actually loaded from the disk, and the final sprite, which is just the sprite is pretty much the texture, the single part of the texture on the whole atlas per texture. Kind of the problem with the pre-packing is that that you'd have a fixed image, a fixed pre-packaged image, which is gonna be harder to repack. You shouldn't really repack at all, because if you have a fixed image with some sprites on it, if there's any free space, packing that up onto a new atlas will mean that free space is never able to be used. As long as you're not doing any graphics intensive work, I guess you are fine to just deploy all your images in one folder with the application. So if you just want to share some examples, you just put it in a folder and people will be happy with it. So first off, we want to find the biggest, or we want to sort all the textures we have by getting the biggest first, which should be pretty easy with Linku. And we're just gonna copy some stuff over. The old Atlas creator is gonna be most likely deprecated anyway. So it's fine to have them double in this case. Okay, they don't really like returning sorted just as is. Probably better off just working on the sorted list and then returning the original. As long as we are doing reference changes only, everything should be fine. Do we need anything else? We still need to check if the atlas is the same. We'll do that last. We'll first try to actually create an atlas. But other than that, writing the atlas finally. This method is just, we're gonna copy it, but for the moment we're not gonna use it. This method pretty much just says, is do we have to load, can we actually use a loaded atlas, or do we have to recreate a new one? And I'm just gonna return true by default. I'm just gonna de-highlight this, all this code, and just say, yeah, it's unreachable, which is okay for us, because we don't use it. So now some bootstrapping for the binary tree. Which we don't have any perfect implementation for, so I guess we'll have just to do some of our own work. Since we specifically do it for this implementation, I'm actually gonna do child write for the write space. Space write of the parent sprite. And another note, child down for space the bottom and technically right of the base sprite. Now we should also have the space that is still remaining, which is pretty much the most important one in this case. We don't really want to know too much, but having the space, I'm just gonna put a paint on it in this case. Imagine we're gonna put a picture here. We know we're gonna add a smaller picture, and the smaller picture should always go to the right if possible. Now this is a right node, this is a bottom node. We now need to know if the new image, let's say it's a little bit bigger, so this is a new image. We want to know if it fits, and we can clearly see it doesn't. We need both width and height for that, of the image which we have. We also need to check the width and height of the remaining space, which is actually, let me see, let's say we have a second image. Now we have this is one node, this is one node, and the width of this space is the whole atlas width, Mine is any parent with. So let's new set. Actually, we don't want to new set because we don't want to have another reference for parents. So what's the remaining space? The remaining space, if we go down a node, we have the root node. Then we have. Okay, I'm gonna hit the right key. That's gonna be big R. Then we have the right node and the. This whole space is right, just to remember. And the bottom node. So how much is the space to the right? This space is exactly the whole width minus all the nodes we have not gone down to. So we'll aggregate the width of the node we've gone down to. And once we've found a finished an empty node, which has no content, then we know all the aggregated, so R width of R plus width of R1 is gonna be the width we have here. We'll also need, can I just add that real quick? We also need a reference to the data we actually save. In this case, we'll save a sprite. But I'm most likely just gonna use the Atlas texture as reference. Do we want to have with as property? I assume so. And height as well. And we may just set that stuff whenever we add a new node. For the moment. Let's start building a tree. So we need a list of tree. New list of tree. For each tree we build, we have to do a new atlas. Viet Damon. Hope I didn't butcher your name there. I got the game and really have been enjoying it. I'm really happy to hear that. Now you can see how we actually developed. Like I said, for each tree we build up, we need one atlas. We also need a fixed atlas size. We will be having a maximum width and a maximum height, which I'm gonna save in the tree. In our case, it's going to be 4096. Due to some graphics card being limited to that. I'm gonna specifically name it tree width and tree height. Both gonna be read only. And we need a constructor. drinking some some delicious water. Always have your water on board, chat. It's always helpful and really great. Better than all the sodas. Just thinking, we'll have to take a look at pretty much each texture. We know that we start with the first texture is going to be the biggest one, and we'll go down in size. I'm just going to add something which we'll have to handle on the mod loader side anyway. If any picked texture is bigger than the maximum allowed on our tree, we have to cancel out. We can't take any texture over 4,000 times 4,000. And we probably start with one tree at least. New tree. Let's just really define it. Otherwise, we're gonna be using some funky code. Or some magic numbers, I think it's called. Which we don't want to use. Always have some point of where you define it. Define numbers. At best, it's one central point, and from there on, you can use all it again and again. Just like a method, just for a fixed number. So in this case, our max atlas size is going to be 4096, since it's always gonna be a perfect square. We don't actually have to do anything more. We don't have to have width and height. We'll be using that over here, and over there, and over here. And in this case, we want to check if the width or the height is too big. If either of them is too big, we will just cancel out. Actually, we'll be throwing an invalid operation exception. We'll be taking this over to the mod loader 2 later. Just gonna have to put a to-do down, because otherwise I will forget it. Generate modded texture atlas. Detection all textures, we'll load the image, and then we'll check if the image we just loaded, the width is bigger than the sprite packer. Dot max atlas size, or if the height is too big for the sprite packer atlas size. Then we will have to debug lock it. I can actually just copy this one. Texture, this one is too big. Please resize it to fit onto the atlas with max width slash height of sprite backup dot xatlas size. And since this is hard to read, we'll be doing something about it. And it's easier to read. So then, now I'm actually implementing it, but whatever. Better implement it now than forget it. We also have to set the missing or broken mods flag to true. This is just to notify the player or the modder, so you guys mostly, to say, yeah, there's some issue, please take a look at your log, and then you will know which issue it is. So this, technically this exception should never throw now, since the only one calling it is that method, but I'm still gonna leave it in, so if at any point I'm reworking it and breaking it, I can instantly see the exception flying. Pixel Gamer, you said how difficult is it to code with that? What do you mean in this case? With SimApp, with Visual Studio, with Unity, or do you mean how difficult is it to program this specific implementation? Pixel Gamer, it's pretty simple. It's just Visual Studio in this case. If you ever want to do any C#, C++, Visual Basic even, pretty much anything on the .NET framework system side, you can just get the Visual Studio community and work with that. It's free. You just have to log in after, I think, 30 days. And you can go ahead and do some programming. Highly recommend to learn it. It's always helpful, especially if you have some computer tasks that you want to automate, or if you want to get into game development as well. Yeah, Damon, you took C++. Yeah, C++ is lovely, but it has pointers. We can technically access pointers in C# too, but I've never worked with them. So I have no clue. For me, pointers, I know how they work, but looking at C++, it's like, yeah, there's stars and then an and symbol, and they do something. I'm not gonna touch that. And hello, randomness extreme. I just started writing a try at texture method. I started to write it as a texture as is, but I'm gonna use a try, which is more or less new. I don't know exactly when it started. I think C# 6 or 7, at least it became very famous. The try syntax is pretty much just the at. Let's start at the other way around. The at is pretty simple. You add something to another thing. But add is usually means the if the method fails, it will also throw an exception and probably break something downstream. The try system is meant to always return a bool and if possible not throw an exception. There's still cases if you did have to throw an exception, especially if you do IO stuff, but the best comparison is if you want to get an int parsed, for example, we can say int dot parse, which is the old one. This would work pretty much fine, but if we just write some text in it, that will straight up throw an exception and break. Now, if you do int dot try pass, this will not work as is, but we can do something really, really great. C sharp added it as an if. You can just say int dot try pass, and we have our string, and as an out parameter, the result. In this case, we could pretty much use it. So if this works, we can go ahead and use it in here. If it doesn't work, it's not gonna go into it. And that's what I want to achieve in this try method as well. Hi, André Kuhl. Weird Daemon, you don't actually have to do that anymore, running the airport overnight. You could use my mod, the Money Giver. I fixed it and it's working again, but only on the current Edge version, not on default. And you can just give yourself some money if you really want to do that. I'd always encourage you to just try to get profits in while you play and in while you build up your airport. Notice at Andre Cool, this is not C++, this is actually C sharp. Like I said before, I'm not gonna touch C++. At least for now. So, any try method usually returns a bool. I haven't seen anything else. We also need to have something that we want to add. In this case, it's a node. And the big part of the try method, there's always an out parameter. Actually, in this case, it's not an out parameter. Oops. Since it's a normal try method. And I actually just noticed we don't just need the width and height, we also need the remaining width and height. I actually said at the start of the stream, I said we need the width as the remaining width, but we actually need the width and the remaining width. We would need both to see if the current node would fit in the remaining space of any node. Do these ones as read-only and say if you want to create a node, we want the width and the height both as fixed fixed read-only variables. So you can change it afterwards. Now we want to try add. If this tree has no root node, that's a pretty simple thing. We just add it as a root node. Meaning we just set root is equal to node. Now we also need to update the nodes remaining with the height. Just gonna make a simple method to help me to just make it a one-liner. Set remaining. With int height, remaining width gleich width, and remaining height gleich height. This means I can always call it in one line instead of setting both from the outside. It's the same result, just a bit nicer. So we set the root node. Now we can calculate what this node has in remaining space. So we'll say node.set remaining space, and we need the width. What if the width is the node width, the tree width, minus the node width. And same for the height, tree height, minus the node.height. So let's compare to our wonderful paintpoint.net. I'm just gonna clean this one. We have a blank atlas, and now we added a sprite. This is our root sprite, the first one we add, always the biggest one. Once that is added, we want to know how much remaining space there is to the right, so the remaining width, and how much remaining height there is, remaining height. And as we see here, the absolute tree width minus the image width is the width we always still have. And the height of this one is pretty simple, it's always the parent node height. Same for this space, this one is the height is important, which is the full height of the atlas minus the sprite height we just added. And the width is always the full width remaining. There's never gonna be a nothing remaining, pretty much. The most interesting thing could be that one sprite actually perfectly hits the bottom, and we'll probably have to check that. So if a sprite perfectly hits the size limit, perfectly uses that up, we cannot add any further sprites. So this is the case for adding the root, but what if we already have a root node? Well, if you have a root node, we pretty much are in this configuration. We always want to try to add a sprite to the right first. Only if it doesn't fit on the right, we want to add it to the bottom. How do we do this? Right and bottom are both children of the main node, which means we'll just say on the main node, public bool try add child, and we have node. Now we can say if the root node is null, we'll just add the root node. We just say this node is the root node. If the root node is not null, so we already have a root node, we want to now refer to this node and its children. We say root dot add triad node, and since we now need a return value, we can also just return it. In this case, this is always true. If the node fits onto the atlas, it's always true. I have to add a quick fix here too. Pretty much gonna do the same as this one again. So if I even if I try to add this too big sprite, it's just gonna stop me from doing so. And we can fancy it up a little, no need for that. If else the else block can go. And return root triad child. So what will happen in this case is it will, whenever we add a new node, it will take a look at the node. If the root node of this tree is still null, we'll say the node is the current node we want to add is our root, and done. Once we have a root node, we cannot set the root node. We want to set the right or bottom space of it, if possible. The root node is always possible, this one is not always possible. So we say root, please try to add this node as child, and let us know if it's possible or not. If it's not possible, we will let to know that we will have to let the caller of triad texture know that this texture doesn't fit onto this atlas. This should only ever return false if it doesn't fit on either to the right nor the bottom side. So let's say we have a really, really big picture here, and this is the remaining space. Now we want to say about this size, add, and we see it would be too far here. If it's at about this size, it doesn't fit to the right, and it doesn't fit on the bottom either. So we want to have this one return false, and then we can add a new tree, which is gonna be the new atlas. For naming sake, I'm also gonna rename this one triad node, so we have consistent naming and not texture. If you want to know, if you're working with Visual Studio and you didn't know, hotkeys are great. Control double R for renaming something. Also, Control comma or Control T to search any type or member. I think I've used it already, but let's say I want to go to the mod loader. Done. Control F for search, of course. And I think that's pretty much the main ones I use anyway. So now, if we want to add a child, like I said, we want to first check the right, then the bottom. Ah, right, I wanted to add a really quick an exception over here. If node.width is bigger than the tree width, or node.height is bigger than the tree height, then throw new invalid operation exception, and I'm just gonna copy this one and actually remove it here, because this one doesn't have to handle it too. This way we've got it handled here. So we've got it handled once, which is enough. It still should never fly, because we've checked in the mod loader and just notified the modder that something is wrong, and please change it. Now try add one child. We want to add one child. We want to try to add one child, which means we definitely want to return a boolean if it's not possible. In this case, we don't want to throw an exception if it's too big. We just want to say, no, it doesn't fit onto the atlas. So that's gonna be the first thing we do. We check if it fits. In this case, we have to just have to think about it. We want to check if either of the nodes can fit it, or if both the nodes are null. Back to paint. If we have this arrangement and we want to add a picture which may be a texture which may be hired too high but not too wide. In this case we want to add it to this one. Goodbye, Carl. So if the node dot width, sorry, the node dot height is greater than the remaining height, which I just have to comment because otherwise I forget it and I'm already doing it wrong. The remaining height is the height remaining, not the height of the right side. Which means the this is the tree height minus the height of this one. Not the best comments of comments, but it does the job in this case. So what we want to check in this case is not the actual remaining height. But if the height to the right is good enough for us. So if the new node is too high, actually if the new node is higher, then our current height, then we know it has to be added to the bottom. Else if the node dot width is greater than our width. Let's see. I think that's actually fine. Let's say we want to add this big of an image. This one can go to the right or to the bottom. Which means we always just have to check the height of the image. So if it's higher, we know it has to go to the bottom. In any other case, we want it to go to the... We want to check the right first, then have it go to bottom. So right first, then bottom. And if we cannot find the space to put it, we will return false. Now let's turn this around actually, because I like it more this way. If the node height, so let's say we have such an image. If the node height is smaller than our height, which is, it is in this case, we can put it here. And it would create this one. We'll still implement this one first. If we want to add to the bottom, we have to check if the bottom is null. So the child down, if this one is null, we can just say child down is gleich is equals to the node we want to add, and we want to set the remaining space to the if we had, let's say, this, then this is our remaining space. Let's make it more general. Let's say if we add this one, our remaining space to the right is going to be the whole width. Minus this width and this width. We actually have this remaining space, so let's use that. The remaining width of this one is the remaining width of the parent, so where we are going to set the child now. Minus the child we had. So we don't use the tree width, but the remaining width, minus the new node we add, and the remaining height minus the node dot height. In general, but if you add one here, let's say like this. In this case, our remaining width, this one, is not the remaining width, it's a tree width. So I most likely have to save both the remaining width and height for the both sides of this thing. So we need this and this and this and this. So let's save that. This should also make the reading it a bit easier. In this case, that's vector 2. Remaining for the right, and v2 remaining for the down child. Actually, I just noticed that the down child isn't the best naming. Might not be the best naming. So let's use bottom. Now we can just set remaining. We want to set both right with remaining, right height remaining, bottom with remaining, and with remaining. And remaining right is equal to new vector 2. Right with remaining and right height remaining and remaining bottom is equal to a new vector, bottom with remaining and bottom height remaining. Perfect. Now, if you want to add the bottom child, actually let's fix this error first. It's always left, right first, correct? Yeah. So right first, we want to set the right first, which is still the correct calculation. It's this node is gonna be the tree width minus the node width we currently at. And it's going to be the tree width minus the node width and height, so we have this. For the bottom, we're going to be adding, since it's the first the root node we add, it's always going to be tree width in the width, and tree height minus node height. Perfect, now we have both coordinates for both sides, for both children, so we can go ahead and get that working a bit better. Just drinking some water. My throat is still a bit done from yesterday, but we still do this stream for you. I do the stream for you. So now if we add a new bottom child, so let's say we have just added this one. Now it should be pretty simple to set the remaining space, since the remaining space overall is already given. The remaining space over here in general is the overall remaining space of the bottom node minus this one's width. So the remaining width, that was the wrong key combo. Let's see, the remaining width that we want to set is the remaining width. Yeah, that is wrong. It's the remaining right. Never mind. The remaining bottom we add to the bottom minus the new node we add dot width. And the remaining right height, so this height, is always going to be the height of this image or texture we add. So it's always going to be node dot height. I think I actually did that wrong up here somewhere. Yeah, this is pretty much the same. This is going to be, if we add the root, this height is always the same as the sprite height. This was this minus this, perfect. Then the remaining bottom width is this, perfect. And height is this one, is the full height minus this one. Stuff all correct. Now the remaining bottom minus the node dot width. In this case, the remaining bottom dot x for width minus the node dot width and the node dot height. This is fixed. Then we want to add. We also want to use. For the remaining space down here, that's gonna be the same as the parent, except for height. The width, if you add to the bottom, the width is gonna stay the same. Like even if you have this one, yeah, it's gonna be the same than its parent. Yeah, if you add this one, we now have to set this and this, the bottom. This is the same as this one already is. So this, the remaining bottom width is gonna stay the same. We remaining bottom dot x, and then we need the remaining bottom height, which is going to be the remaining height minus sprite height. So remaining bottom dot y minus node dot width. Okay, what's wrong? It doesn't want to convert. Yeah, okay. We don't actually need to use this. We need to use vector 2 ins, which is a vector 2, but for integers. It's the whole difference is that vector 2 just save comma values, whereas a normal a vector 2 int only saves full values. So 1.1 is a float comma value, and 1 is a full value. In this case, we always work with full pixels. I haven't seen any graphics card that may display like half pixels. Let me know if you have seen something like that. But for the moment, I think pretty much all graphics cards just accept full pixels, and so we only need that. Just saw an issue. We want that right width, right height. Ah, okay. Bottom width remaining. Never mind. Bottom height remaining. Auto completion can be really dangerous if you guys auto complete. Make sure you're actually correctly auto completing. Now, if you want to, if we have the space on the right, no, wait, let's finish this one first. So if we have no bottom node, then we always just say, yeah, please add this as the bottom node. We need to check the space first though. So let's have a private bool can fit right, which is gonna be, the right one's gonna be simple, the right one is just node n. This is just the one we pretty much just brought already. Node dot height n dot height is smaller than height, our height. In this case, we can probably fit to the right. To be sure, we can also check that the width is smaller than remaining width. So the n dot width must be smaller than our remaining right dot width, which is x. And I'm just gonna make a second helper for bool can fit bottom node n. And it's gonna be if the if the node's height is smaller than the remaining height and the remaining width. So n dot height is smaller than the remaining height, remaining bottom in this case, remaining bottom dot y for the height, and n dot width is smaller than the remaining Right, bottom dot x. Now let's reformat this a little. If this one, if can fit right, then we want to try to add it to the right. Else if can fit bottom, which I completely butchered. Can fit bottom and otherwise, if it can't fit either on the right or the bottom, you can just say return false, which is the indication for us that we need a new atlas. Now, if we can fit it to the bottom, the bottom is null, and we just say, yeah, this bottom node at the child bottom is now going to be the node. We set the remaining space and return true, because we now have space used or reserved for this texture. If there's already a child node, then we go further. Child dot bottom dot try, yeah, child. And that one can just take care of the node. Now we pretty much just call the same method. If you haven't programmed at any time, or if you haven't programmed too long, you might not notice this, but this is recursion. It's called in programming recursion. In this case, we recurse down the tree. So we have our root. Let's say we want to add a new thing, and the thing does fit to the right. Bloop, fit to the right. Now we want to see if another thing fits, maybe even smaller than this one. And we now need to check for everyone. So let's say this is a size. Now this one sees, oh, this is small enough for my right. Cool, so, but I already have something on the right, so I cannot add it to the right. So we ask our right node, hey, right node, can you please take a look at this? So right node says, hey, yeah, sure. Bloop, adds it. Since the right node doesn't yet have a new right node, we just add it. Now, question, if, let's say we have a something that is about this size. Actually, let's say about this size. This will technically fit to the right, but there's no space left for it. Which means our root node would currently ask the right node, take a look if you can add it. The right node will return false. It cannot add it. But we could technically add it to the bottom, which means we cannot do else if. We have to both. We have to check both. We always check the right first, but we always want to also check the bottom. If the bottom cannot add it anymore, then we'll definitely return false. Because then we know that we have reached the end. If the right can add it, we want to see if the child to the right is equal to null. And if it's equal to null, then our child right is our node dot set remaining is gonna be the same as this one, if I'm thinking correctly. just instead of using tree width, we will be using remaining right dot x. Remaining right dot x and remaining right dot y. Let's just check. Let's say we want to add this one. Now our remaining, this one, remaining right, the width factor is gonna be the remaining right we have, minus the node we add, perfect. Then the right, this one is just the height of the node, perfect. Then we want to add this one, the width first, the width is gonna be the remaining right, this one doesn't change, it's from this node the remaining right. Still, and the height is gonna be the remaining height from the node minus this one's height. Perfect. It works, chat. It works. At least the calculation is correct. It may not work yet. Now, if the child is not null, right, first we want to return true because we now added it. If the child to the right is not null, we pretty much just do the same. We ask the child to the right to please add it. Now in this case I said we only want to return if this returns true. So let's add an if. If this returns true, we definitely want to return true. This may look a bit funky, but it does the right job. If if it cannot be added to the right, this would return false, so the if is not executed, so this one would never return. And then it can take a look and check if it fits to the bottom. So we always check if it can fit right first. If it can fit, it will be added. If it can't fit, we will always check if it can fit to the bottom. If it can fit, it will be added. Or the child node is going to be asked if it can be added. And if it can fit to the bottom, it's just instantly returning false. If there's a node there, it's going to ask the node, can I fit this node down the bottom of your point? And that's probably the whole implementation side for the tree. So let's add some textures to the trees. In this case, we always start with one tree. And I'm gonna write a small helper method, private static void add to tree. Actually, I think I don't need it. Rethinking about it. So let's see. We have a texture. Ah, yeah, now I know why I wanted to write it. Private static void add to trees. Because we have one node, we want to add one node n, but we have several trees. List of trees, and this method is gonna take care of adding it, but also of adding a new tree if the current tree doesn't, if the current node doesn't fit on the already existing trees. And to check, we have to check all trees. At least we have to check all trees until we find one we can put the node on. If we find none, we add a new one. The biggest problem really, or the point why I'm adding a new method for this, is that we have two for each and it's usually more fancy to have them both separated so that we don't go too deep of a territory. This is most likely I'd have to check, but this is probably gonna be optimized by the compiler and just inlined into the top method. So it doesn't really matter on performance-wise. So we'll take a look at our trees. And if our tree that we currently look at can add a node, the node n, then return true. Actually, we just return because this one's already going to take care of adding the trees. So we will just return, and if it returns, we know we don't need a new tree. If all trees have been searched and we cannot add it, we don't have space on all the trees, then we want to add a new tree. So trees.add new tree with the same max atlas size. And then trees.last. Okay, maybe I'm going actually adding a new custom variable for it. New tree equals to that. And then trees.add. If I could type new tree and new tree dot triad node. And this should always work. This shouldn't ever not work. The only way this couldn't work is if the texture we want to add is too big for any atlas. So let's see. Let's actually check if we have a list and we order it and we are acting on the ordered dictionary, on the ordered list. Does that still run on the base or change the base? So if we have a list of string with A, B, actually A, C, B, me and my typing. Perfect. Now we have sorted equal to blah.orderby. Itself just. So now we have sorted, which is an ordered enumerable of string in this case. And it's sorted, so now if we... Yeah, that's not gonna change it. So I'm going to probably have to list it best up here. Now... We have our input textures. And they are sorted. And we take a look at an atlas texture. We need to make a node from that atlas texture. So we will do an atlas node equals to a new node. And that node has fixed height and width, which is from the atlas texture. We can just take the atlas texture dot load the info texture dot width and the atlas texture dot info texture dot height. And then we say add to trees atlas texture. So this is pretty much not needed. That one is going to be inlined, which I cannot do until it's fixed. So it needs trees. I said trees. And now we can just remove this one. Or not. Sometimes Visual Studio doesn't like it. Oh, never mind. I just have to put them into the correct one. Yeah, sometimes it doesn't like it, but we can format this at this one. No need for the extra variable, and if you already have a single line, we can just do it like this. This is pretty much just gonna make us atlases. But it's not gonna finish making the atlas itself. This is going to create our binary tree. So our programming representation of what our atlas should be. Now, let's say we want to know the position of any atlas texture on the atlas, which means we need some more data. Just another vector to int position. No. We want to say public void set position. And x and y, and this one is just position equals to new vector to int x y. This case is the easiest one. It's just node dot set position 0,0. And before we continue, let's see what Unity is actually doing. Unity UV coordinates. Okay, so we've been working from the top left, but Unity is actually using the bottom left, so we have to keep that in mind. In the end, that should still be valid with our current graph, but we'll have to see, we'll have to take a look at this. While checking that, we also can already take a look at how do we actually add the textures to another texture, which is going to be probably pretty simple. Let's see, Unity add texture to another texture. That's really helpful. This is not helpful, this is just putting it on the render texture. This is probably still gonna work. Let's see, render texture. Can we get the underlying texture out of it? Doesn't seem like, but it inherits from texture. Let's see if we have a render texture, new render texture with a some width and height and one depth. I don't know what the depth is in this case. Can we get the texture? No, we cannot. So we can use a render texture in this case. Next thread. Let's see. Taking a texture, bending a circle onto the texture. It seems like it's just gonna be get pixel and set pixel. Oh, never mind. Ah, this is a big problem. Luckily we found it. Metal and WebGL. WebGL we can ignore, but Metal is actually the API we use on Mac. Which means Arthur is not gonna be happy about it if we try to use this one. It's not gonna work on any Mac. So he could never use mods. So I guess we'll have to fall back to just using texture. Unity, texture, set pixel, and probably cat pixel, I guess. Let's see, yeah, get pixel is gonna get a color, add X and Y, and then we just set pixel. Actually, we build up a color array, and then set that array. Let's make a small little utility class for that. Copy texture. Oh, never mind, that's a bad class name. Let's say texture util. Yes, please. And it's gonna be sim.utils and a public class. Static for that matter. It's gonna be public static. Probably void, since we work on the texture and we actually change the texture instead of returning a new one. So public static void, copy texture. And we want the texture. I'm using texture, right? I'm actually using texture 2D, which is gonna be annoying. It probably has a texture. Oh, never mind, we have to use texture 2D anyway. So that's fine. So it's gonna be texture 2D. Control dot, using Unity Engine. The source. Actually, destination. Grain source principle. DST for destination. Texture 2D. Source. And int DST. X and int DST Y. We're just going to be where we want to put it. Now we want to build an array. That copies our array, and it's a new array of color. And the length of this array is going to be the source done to width. Times the source dot height. And I'm just going to add a to do. This could be optimized by using graphics.copy texture, but it's not supported on metal. Consider consider with S, yeah. Consider using graphics on TX and OpenGL. Now we just loop over the data we have in source. Which were pixel in pixel color probably in SRC dot. I probably cannot get it like this way. Get pixel. Oh, we can do get pixels. Oh, this makes it actually way easier. Because this makes it a one-liner. DST dot set pixels, I bet. Yeah, perfect. This makes it way simpler. Set pixels, it's gonna set a whole block at 0 mipmap level, and we want to say where we want to set it. Ah yeah, this one is completely different. We want to say that set it at destination X and destination Y, and we want to say the width is going to be the source width and the source height is height. And then which colors do we want to set? We want to set the source dot get pixels, and in this case we want to set just get all pixels, which is probably this one, but it's completely not documented. So let's take a look at the documentation online, and it has zero documentation, I guess. Yeah, it has absolutely no documentation. There's documentation for a specific mipmap level, there's documentation for X, Y, and all of this stuff, but the documentation for get pixels without anything is completely missing. So, in this case, we'll have to find out ourselves. We could test it, but we can also check the source. Maybe in this case, the source of Unity is going to be helpful. So we say texture2d.get pixels and say source, Unity source, please, not some random. It's a Unity decompiled, it should do the job as well. Let's see if it's too old version. 2016 is pretty old. Arthur was just nice enough to write me, it gets a list of color array. It gets me the color array, which, yeah, I know, but is it going to give me the whole? Is it gonna give me the whole image, or is it gonna be just the first pixel, which I can also think of? While waiting for an answer, we can also check ourselves. Yeah, it's just gonna be the whole image. So this will do the copy, but Arthur just said it's probably better to just iterate for allocations. I'm gonna just to do it, and not gonna do it now, but optimize it later. Optimize this to actually iterate this allocably. We can always optimize it later before pushing to edge, but I'm not gonna do more than maybe half an hour, and we might want to check if we can get some results out. So this we'll have to do. If you build our trees, for each tree we need, so build trees, for each tree we want to build a texture and add all textures of the tree to that texture. So, for tree. Trees. We want to create an atlas for the tree, which is the atlas itself is also just the texture 2D. So this is the easy side. Why atlas like equals new texture 2D. And we'll always use the biggest size. Actually, let's use the variable. Now, we cannot just for each. We actually have to go down all the nodes, which we can for each if we have the correct function for it. So let's say public. Actually, we can just get to the root node and ask this one, so we only need to add the function on the node. Public IEnumerable of node. we'll need the function actually in tree. For each node, we want to Arthur is currently not helping. He's writing also Skull Vikings. Are the Vikings playing first? Oh yeah. So chat, just so you know, I'm a Packers fan. Arthur is a Viking fan. I'm actually happy if the Vikings win tonight, because then we have to play the Vikings and not the 49ers next week. But yeah, back to coding. And yeah, lovely rivalry. So for each node, we want to return the child nodes if possible, if there is a child node. Which means let's say we have a function get nodes. This function will return, if possible, the child is right. It actually has to be a boolean if that is not null. Return child right, and if the child bottom is not null. Return child bottom. I can write return child bottom. Since this is an IEnumerable, we actually have to say child return and child return. IEnumerable for C# guys, for non-C# developers. This just says that we want to return this one. But for the next iterator or the next iteration, we will also want to return this one. So at the end, both are returned if they are not null. Now the problem is it doesn't return itself. I won't do that because then itself would be returned more than once. Like if we return the child right here, but also return ourselves, then the child right would return itself, because we also have to yield return, which have to say for each child. Oh yeah, this is going to be annoying. We need braces. We want to return the child right, and we want to return each node or child in child right. Get nodes. We also want to child return that child. And the same for this one. Add braces. Never copy paste, chat. Never copy paste. You just copy paste your errors. And in this case, child bottom. And we want to say in tree public enumerable of node get nodes, which is just going to be if root doesn't equal null, yield return root, and for each var child in root.getNodes return yield return child. So now we've got a way to add to get access all the nodes. Node in add in tree.getNodes. Now we have to copy paste. I just said it's bad, but let's just copy paste all the textures onto the atlas. To do so, we say texture utils dot copy texture. And we'll be using our atlas as destination, the node dot atlas texture dot input texture as the source, and the position the node position dot x and the node dot position dot y. And I think we haven't actually done that correctly already. Let me see. We set this node position. But yeah, we never set the child node positions. So what is a children node position? In this case, it's node.position. We have an x and a y. If we add this right, so this one, our new x, we are still working with the top left position, but we'll have to convert that for UV for Unity to bottom left. But bottom left is pretty easy to convert to because it's just go down by the just add height, actually 0 comma height as vector to the position. But currently on the tree, let's just work with this one, which is going to be, we want to add this one, child right, so it's gonna be our width, comma, our own y, because the y doesn't change, it's the same y. So it's going to be width, actually it's going to be position dot x plus width. So let's say we add a new one. This position is now the width plus our own position. But the position dot y is gonna be the same. Now for the bottom one, it's gonna be reversed. The position dot x is gonna be the same, whereas the y, so let's say we add one here, the x is gonna be the same, it's not gonna move to the right. Even if we add one here, it's still the same as the parent node, but the y is gonna change. The y is gonna change to the parent's position y plus the parent height. So position dot y plus height. Cool, now we can copy it. Okay, for this one, since this is the actual copy, now we need the bottom left based system, for which I'm just gonna do a simple property, read-only property, vector to int, reposition, which is going to be the position, plus new vector to int, 0, since the x is not gonna change, but we want to pivot the get the pivot down from top left to the bottom left, so only our y changes, and our y changes exactly by the height. And this is actually unity position, UV position. The UV position would be a fraction, so 0 to 1 base system. And we can just say unity position and unity position. Let's see, is that correct? Yeah, it's taking ints, perfect. Now, when setting a new node, we technically also want to set the Atlas texture UV, but I'm not gonna do that now. I'm just gonna return the sorted list to do set UVs on textures. Actually, that's probably pretty easy. Yeah. It's actually not too easy if you're just on a node. Actually, you have to calculate it up here. So whenever copying one, we can also set the UV, which is going to be the vector 2. Why don't I make a specific rect for it? The Atlas rect. New Atlas rect. I'm always only copying from a rect. So we'll actually take a look at it later. Do that, and if you have a finished atlas, if you finished packing one, so we technically this is packing one atlas. Once it's finished, we want to save it to the disk. Which I can just steal from here. Now saving to this is gonna be technically a bit more interesting, because we also have to write the list of textures the let me see. Yeah, the list of Atlas texture. This is because the to pretty much just save the data, save which atlas was generated, so we don't have to regenerate the atlas all the time. For the moment, let's just use this one. We have atlas as our atlas texture, and we encode it to PNG, atlas path, and this is going to be a bit more interesting. We have several atlas paths. So what we'll do is just int number gleich 0, and for each rewrite it's gonna be nbr plus plus, and it's going to be some hard coding plus nbr plus dot png. Now, let's go to the mod loader and see real quick if it has worked. If it's working. reload all the textures exactly instead of writing. Actually, let's just do both. So new sprite packer dot packatlas, and it's gonna take the loaded mod textures. Actually, it's gonna be textures this way. Generate atlas textures, pack atlas textures. Now, if we've done everything right, we should get an atlas. Perfect, just making sure we don't load into a save. We can, with some developer tools, we can load, for example, into one save directly. Which makes debugging a little bit easier, since we can just skip the main menu. But we just need to load any save to see if this works or not. Well, we haven't got any exceptions, so let's see what we have in our mods folder. That's the old atlas, but not the new atlas. Let's see if we can really quickly debug this issue. Otherwise, I'm gonna end it pretty soon. Oh, never mind. It's just not a. Does it just not called? Peg Atlas. Ah, I know why. It's not. No wonder. Yeah. The mod loader actually checks if the Atlas is the same one as the loaded one. No, wait, it doesn't. Ooh, I'm just not having any mod textures. Let's see. We need some mod textures, so let's say the floor pack and this stuff. Yeah, this stuff will do. Let's do it again. Hey, exceptions. Ah, yeah, no wonder. Wait, actually, wonder. So it seems to be building the tree correctly. But it seems like there's something null. See what is now. Atlas is fine, which I would expect. Input texture should be fine. Never mind, the node doesn't have an atlas texture. Which makes sense. I'm never adding one. Let's do this and say node gleich that one, and then let's say node.atlas texture is equal to atlas texture, and add to trees node and trees, and this can be initialized better, I know, can be simplified, there you go. So, this time we didn't have an issue. Let's see if we have a generated atlas. Yep. That is looking like an atlas to me. It doesn't look perfect though. Yeah. There's still some issues with spacing of stuff. This is pretty much because we aren't using the top left corner. This stuff should all be one further down, and this one would pretty much perfectly fit here, I guess. And yeah, this one would perfectly fit here. I'm also not quite sure why it's not filling to the right first, which it should. Actually, that makes sense. We only fill to the right if needed. And yeah, the problem is currently it's completely reversed due to we using the top left corner versus Unity using the top bottom left corner. So this whole thing would need some reversing. But otherwise, it seems pretty good already. It packed. So let's note that down. To do currently packs the wrong way around slash with wrong pivot. Unity is using bottom left. We are using top left. And this has to be fixed throughout the whole tree pretty much. But that's gonna be, I'm either gonna do it off cam one of the next day, or we will do it in the next stream if you guys want to see an extra. But for today, that's gonna be it. Thank you to everyone who joined me in doing some development work. I hope to see you all next time. If you want to participate either in chat or help me do some research or check out what we do in each stream, I'm probably gonna start using some form of voting so you guys can check or vote for what we do. But anyway, if you want to participate in any way, check out the Discord. There's always a link up on the general discussion over on Steam, and you can go ahead and join there and either mod with us or talk with us, and especially see whenever we do another live stream. Thanks everyone for coming on, watching. If you watch this in as a recording, leave a comment, leave a like if you want to. And if you have anything to suggest for modding stuff, either put it as an issue on GitHub or leave it as a comment. And but please check the list I posted on the first bit of the stream I showed you. If it's already on the list, we don't need it to put it on the list again. Anyway, we'll see you next time. Either me alone again, or next time whenever we do our normal dev stream. Hope you have a lovely weekend and a great night tonight. Probably with football if you're in the US. Good night, everyone.